Nice to see you. Thank you for talking with us.
Hey, thanks, Shannon.
Okay, so now that the president of the University of Pennsylvania has stepped down, how does that institution and really other colleges and universities around the country, including here in Western PA, solve the problems they face regarding free speech and safety?
Well, I don't think this solves any problem. All it does is it sends a message that anti-Semitic tolerance can cost one his or her job. So I think it's really important. But remember, these colleges and universities have atrocious track records upholding First Amendment rights. In fact, UPenn ranks one of the last. They're beat only by Harvard in terms of their First Amendment record, in terms of being bad on the First Amendment. So it's amazing how these colleges and universities will let, they'll crack down on all kinds of speech, but they'll let anti-Semitic speech go.
I'm thinking about university leadership here in Western Pennsylvania, which there's a lot of it, and we want students to be able to speak their minds all over Western Pennsylvania. But how, as a member of Congress, can you advise leadership on campuses about balancing safety and free speech?
So what's interesting is there's a standard in the universities that the universities will crack down on speech that they don't agree with, that they don't find politically acceptable. But they were allowing speech to move forward that called for the genocide of the Jews. And that's where this particular professor got in trouble, because as a dean of the university, she refused to call out anti-Semitism.
But speaking of that, what do you want the people in Western Pennsylvania to know about where you stand, not just on the Israel-Hamas war, but also on the war in Ukraine? And how do your stances on those two wars factor into policy regarding funding from the U.S.?
Okay, so I of course stand with the people of Israel, been very supportive of Israel, and just not abroad. I think we have to fight anti-Semitism at home, and that's really the reason why I pushed forward that letter as well, to make sure that the president of Penn was asked to step down for her unwillingness to call out anti-Semitic remarks on campus.
Moving forward, you know, what do you want to tell people here in Western PA, our viewers from Pittsburgh's Action News 4, about as somebody who it impacts the purse strings?
Yeah, so I sit on the Appropriations Committee. We're running we're looking at a supplemental bill that would be in four or five parts, maybe three parts, but it would look at funding Israel, making sure that we give the Israelis what they need. Ukraine is in there, borders in there, and also Taiwan to meet the rising threats of China. That supplemental will probably run early next year, all those supplementals. But there's another thing to consider here. We also need to make sure that we're supplementing our own supplies. A lot of what you're seeing in those aid packages are simply to restockpile our own arms and ammunition. We need to make sure that those, like the Israelis, the IDF that is fighting terrorism, the Ukrainians that are fighting Putin, that they have the weapons they need to actually win these wars. And I'm going to be working within Congress and in my role in the Appropriations Committee and on the Rules Committee and as Chief Deputy Whip to make sure our allies have the resources that they need to execute and win these wars, and also to make sure that we prevent wars such as Taiwan. If we had armed the Ukrainians ahead of time, I would argue that we had a chance of preventing that war. We should look at that lesson and arm Taiwan so that the CCP, Chinese Communist Party, won't invade Taiwan.
It's interesting that you mentioned that, because former President Trump, you know, there was an issue with one of his impeachments regarding arming Ukraine and making sure they had, you know, the weaponry needed to defend itself. Do you still stand with former President Trump? And do you, to that end, do you believe that he bears any responsibility for the January 6th attack on the Capitol and the deaths that ensued?
No, so we got to remember that the individual who qualified aid on Ukraine was actually Joe Biden. And then he went and bragged about it on live TV, saying that he did not give aid, he would not give aid unless a prosecutor was fired. So we know that went on. President Trump sent lethal aid to Ukraine in the form of Stinger missiles, for example.
Let's talk a little bit more about immigration. You know, that has been tied in recent days to the conversation regarding funding for Israel and also Ukraine. Nutshell it for us. This immigration is not a new problem. What is the problem and how would you solve it?
Well, for one, we've got a border that's not secure. We've got tactical control at the southern border that's in the hands of the drug cartels. These are people that do not care about United States citizens at all. They frankly don't care about the people that are coming across the border either. They're some of the most exploited, abused people. It's truly a humanitarian crisis. We also have to remember that fentanyl is killing over 300 people every single day here in the United States. That fentanyl is coming through our southern border. Some of it is produced in China. Some of it is produced by the Chinese in Mexico. So it's a huge problem. Additionally, we have people that have gotten caught that have been on the terrorist watch list, roughly 100 people on the terrorist watch list, which begs the question, how many people on the terrorist watch list came across the border that we have not apprehended? It only took 19 terrorists to cause 9/11. There's probably many more than 19 individuals on the terrorist watch list that have already come across the southern border. This is a huge, massive problem that can't be overstated.
All right, so what's the solution?
It's a multifaceted solution. I mean, for one, we should go back to the policies we had in the last administration. We actually saw a decline in illegal immigration. Our remain in Mexico policy, which is in accordance with international law, where someone that's seeking asylum has to seek asylum from the first safe nation they arrive to. That would be Mexico, of course, if you're coming from Central America. Making sure that we're funding Border Patrol, making sure that we're ending the catch and release policy of the Biden administration, for example. We should also look at having infrastructure on the southern border. There's places that a border wall should be built and we should complete construction. We should have drones. We should have other technology to make sure to make sure that we're actually catching individuals as they come across. We also need to put pressure on Mexico to push back on the drug cartels that are bringing illegal immigrants and narcotics through that southern border into the United States, and hold Mexico accountable for some of this as well.
What is the Cold Case Modernization Act? Mm-hmm.
So I'm, as you know, as a former district judge, I was a prosecutor and defense attorney in the Navy. Cold cases are very important. This would give resources so that we can go back and look at cold cases. Look at rape kits, for example, that haven't been processed, which is a huge issue because the recidivism rate is very high in those cases. Look at individuals that have not been identified and run those DNA tests. And that will solve, hopefully, some cold cases. We're having huge technological breakthroughs, and there should in cold case technology, particularly extracting DNA evidence from scenes and from unidentified persons, that should be used in a database to make sure that we're solving these cases and pushing that forward.
Okay, let's talk a little bit about some other issues that have come up and may come up for sure in this next election cycle for you. You're be running next year. When it comes to firearms, would there be any way in which you would support something like a red flag law, universal background checks, or limiting ammunition as far as the size of magazines?
No. No, absolutely, absolutely not.
Well, let's go into a little bit more of universal background checks. Tell me more about that. Why not?
I don't support universal background checks. The Obama administration, Secretary Johnson said, you can't do universal background. You can't do confiscation without universal background checks. Universal background checks are the first step to having confiscation. Also, everyone talks about the loophole of gun shows. Pennsylvania doesn't have that loophole. We do background checks at gun shows in Pennsylvania.
But you can still sell or give a gun to a family member or something like that, and they may not be the best person to own a gun.
Yeah, and that would be called a felon in possession of a firearm, which is already a crime. I think that's what you're alluding to. So that's already criminal behavior and conduct that should be prosecuted.
Is there any way, you know, do you see mass shootings in this country as a problem? And if so, is there a solution?
Yeah, so Pittsburgh has a homicide rate that's greater than Chicago per capita. We can start by actually having policing, community policing, making sure the police are engaged, and making sure those that should not have a firearm, like felons, are prosecuted.
Was the 2020 election stolen, presidential election?
Well, I'll tell you what, it wasn't fair and it wasn't square, but there's an election coming up in 2024, and the voters are going to have a chance probably to vote on the same candidates they had before. My prediction is President Trump wins in 2024.
So again, was it or was it not stolen, as former President Trump has claimed?
So you had a laptop that you had people within the intel community, so-called experts, say was Russian disinformation. That was not Russian disinformation. The intel community knew that. And the mainstream media, the legacy media, shut it down. Social media shut it down. That would have made a difference in the election. That's Rasmussen polling saying that. That's not me. So we know that had an impact in the election.
Where do you stand on abortion?
So I believe that life begins at conception and it ends at natural death.
Would you support a prisoner swap to get Mark Fogel home to Oakmont?
Yeah, of course I would support it. That's what I'm doing in Congress, is trying to get him included in a SWAT. The Biden administration has not placed him on wrongfully detained status. The reason that's important is you need to be on wrongfully detained status in order to be eligible to a SWAT. We should have, in the last SWAT with Victor Boot, we should have had Fogel in there. We should have Brittany Griner in there. We should have had Mark Whelan in there as well. I don't think Gersovich was taken prisoner at that time. But Fogel should be on wrongfully detained status. He's still not on wrongfully detained status, despite the fact that he had almost identical a fact pattern to Brittany Griner. It's absolutely inexcusable that he's not on wrongfully detained status. I don't think the administration is working hard enough to bring him home. We need media attention. We need to make sure that there's language in the appropriations bills, which I have, to actually compel the administration to explain why they're not putting him on wrongfully detained status. And then we've got to make sure that we get attention on the case to actually get Mark Fogel back to Pittsburgh.
Is there anything that people here in Western PA can be doing to help that end?
Yes, you can be calling your elected representatives, pushing for Mark Fogel to be included, put on wrongfully detained status, to be included in a prisoner swap. And that would be good. Also, what you're doing now, asking me questions about Mark Fogel, is key. We need to get media attention on Mark Fogel, because at the end of the day, there was media attention that brought Brittany Griner home. So we need the same sort of media attention on Mark Fogel to compel action from the administration to bring him home as well.
Where do you stand on Paul Whelan?
Well, he should have been included in the last swap too. The difference between, and of course, I think Whelan should be brought home. Whelan is on wrongfully detained status. So my bill is focused on Mark Fogel, because Mark Fogel, unlike Whelan and Griner, has not been put on wrongfully detained status. Again, you have to be on wrongfully detained status to be put in a prisoner swap.
And just curious, you know, are there other Americans who sort of fall in the same category as Mark Fogel who aren't on that wrongfully detained list yet, who need to be elevated to that? And how many are we talking?
Yeah, so my legislation will address that, because right now it's very opaque. We know about the Mark Fogel case because I'm from Pittsburgh, he's from Pittsburgh. There's attention on Mark Fogel. I've talked to his family. But my legislation would require the State Department within 90 days to making a determination whether or not somebody should or should not be on wrongfully detained status, to turn those documents over to Congress, so we actually have clarity and transparency as to what is going on.